students and guests present here today. I am proudly welcoming our guest for today, Mr. Rajesh Audicha. Now he has over 8-9 years of experience, initially as a graphic designer. And at some point he realized he needs to upgrade his knowledge. So he has then upgraded himself to UI designing. He has got a lot of work experience in multiple companies. He has been gaining and broadening his horizon by working for social media marketing. He has been, you know, building websites, mobile apps, lot of things related. And right now, currently, he is working in Ria Group as a UI and UX designer finally. For them, he is doing again lot of websites, app designing, campaigns, microsite. So if you have any doubts about all these above, you are most free to ask him any questions since he has got so much experience. So let's begin now. One more thing, students, at the end, we will have a question and answer session. So you can, you know, in the chat box mention or have type in all your queries and doubts. And towards the end, he will answer all your doubts. So he'll first have his session and eventually answer all your questions in the end. So let's begin. Over to you, Mr. Rajesh. You can begin.
Aditya. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yeah.
So good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for the honor, Mahesh sir. So I'll like to tell you all a short journey of mine. Initially in 2013 I started as a graphic designer. I was working for a small firm as a social media marketing post creator over there. I was handling social media accounts for them, and I was creating Facebook, LinkedIn and other kind of different marketing material and posts for them. And after that I started working with Datacom Web Technologies. There I was again working as a graphic designer. I was creating marketing creative for a mobile app. So after that, they gave me an opportunity to design mobile UI and mobile flows over there. So I started working for brands like HDFC, Aditya Birla Group and SBI. I created UI for them, user journey as well. And after that, I started working in a e-learning company. There also I created e-learning interactive courses for them. And now I'm working with Ria Tours and Travels as the UI UX designer. So what I do? So I have been creating microsites, mobile app, landing pages and other digital marketing stuff for Ria Tours and Travels. They have a variety of products like flight air tickets, holidays, hotels and visa services. To promote those services and products, I create digital content for them. Majorly it is the websites and microsites, and a few for initial you can say the festival stuff or other you can say offers for them. I create landing pages, and there are monthly newsletter. We also create those newsletter and mailers. So how do I design and what do I do? So we'll get into it. So what is user interface? So we are going to talk about user interface today. So whatever you are interacting with right now is a user interface. In your hands, you're using a mobile. Whatever you click on it, that is also a user interface. So whatever is visible on your screen, that is a user interface. But user interface is not just digital. It is also the keyboard which you are using, that is also a user interface. The switchboard at your home, that is also a user interface. Remotes of your TV, that is also a user interface. Everything whichever you interact and gives you a reply, that is a user interface. If you click on your keyboard, the screen will show some action or reaction. That is the user interface. So while creating a user interface, what all things you need to keep in mind, we'll discuss about that. So things to keep in mind while designing a user interface. See, if you see this example of a login screen, the user should know what he is looking at, where he is, and what kind of action he needs to take while looking at the UI. So there should be a clarity. If you see the second example, there that is also a login screen. But if you compare this both, when you see the first example, the user doesn't have the hierarchy and proper call to action. If you see, all these three buttons are having the high priority, then user might get confused what he need to do, what kind of an action he need to take. So if you see at the second example for the login screen, he has a specific set of actions need to be taken. Login me, that is the main primary button which he need to click, and other buttons are secondary. So you need to give a clarity to the user what set of action he need to take, where he is and what he is about to do. So we move towards the second. So second thing you need to keep in mind is familiarity. Well, while creating a UI, if the user sees a similar stuff, similar UI, then he'll be very pleased to interact with that product. If you can see Amazon and Flipkart, they have both search bars on the top. They both have the hamburger menu on the left hand side. They have the cart on the right hand side. While creating the UI, you need to study the familiar products which are already there in market. So while creating the UI, you have to give that familiar feel to the user so that he can understand what things he need to do, and it will make his life easy to interact with your UI. You have to study his different apps which he is interacting. You have to do the market study of what other competitors are doing, and as per that you have to create a similar but a unique UI so that your users should feel familiar to it, but he is getting some crux out of your UI. So going towards the next point, consistency. While creating a UI,
just for the previous slide, just on an average, how much time do you give for this, since this is an important topic? How much time do you spend on this topic? Also, how many, for example, I take 10 companies app into consideration, or 5 or 1, if you could share a few numbers on that.
As per these two giants are there, these are the e-commerce companies. You have to see how many competitors are doing great and what all downloads they have on Play Store. You have to take that into the consideration. Then you come to know what kind of numbers are there, what kind of people are using them. So as per that, you have to create the UI. There are also reviews in the Play Store which you can read and get an insight of what they are lacking behind and what you need to improvise while creating the UI.
Yes.
So these are all the factors.
Okay.
So consistency. While creating a UI, if you are creating a mobile app, if your first screen looks different and the second screen look different, then the user will get confused where he is landing. If you are creating a website, the home page looks different and other pages look different, then he might be redirected to something else. So he'll get confused and he'll not use your app. So you have to create a UI grid to make the entire product consistent. For that, you have to define your background colors, your color scheme, what kind of color scheme you're using, your typography, size of your font, hierarchy, and the buttons. All that stuff you have to keep in mind while designing a UI. See, you have to create a user guide. You have to create a proper style guide to create your entire product. If you are creating one screen with a different style and other screen with a different style, then the user will not get a proper feel of your product. So you have to keep your entire screen consistent, entire product consistent, and website consistent. So consistency plays a major factor in your UI. So you have to create a style guide before creating the entire product. For creating a style guide, what you can do is you can create the first screen of your website or mobile app. As per that, you can create assets. Assets can be your background color, your typography, your font which you're using, your color screen, primary color, secondary color, what type of buttons you're using, active, what he is there for. Then your UI doesn't make any sense. You have to provide your user with an efficient way of doing his task. He's there to get his work done. So while creating a UI, you have to understand that thing as well. See, you can make your app or website efficient by reducing the clicks, reducing the number of screens which he need to go through, by reducing the number of form fields which are there on the website or UI, So by making all that kind of stuff, you can zip it up and you can make the steps less. That will make the user more efficient towards his goal. So you have to design a UI in such a way that your user should make his task with less efforts. He need to complete his goal with less efforts. So you have to design a UI in that way that he completes his task in very less time. So you have to keep that in mind. You anyhow need to reduce your clicks, and you can even create shortcuts so that he can navigate easily.
Okay, Rajesh, can you reshare the screen? Because yeah, probably there are some patches which are coming. Can you just stop sharing and reshare the PPT again?
Okay. So can you see it now?
Just hold on. Just come. Yeah, we have kind of a similar thing. Yeah, you go ahead. It's still the same. Yeah.
Okay. The next step is the responsiveness. Whenever you are creating a UI and whenever you are giving your client a call to action, you need to give him a proper feedback towards it. See, UI is always action and reaction. If not giving a proper feedback to your client, he will get frustrated and he'll leave your app or website. Imagine you have a website, you have a button over there, and the user is... The next step is the responsiveness. Whenever you are creating a UI and whenever you are giving your client a call to action, you need to give him a proper feedback towards it. See, UI is always action and reaction. If not giving a proper feedback to your client, he will get frustrated and he'll leave your app or website. Imagine you have a website, you have a button over there, and the user is always clicking but he is not getting any feedback from it. Then it is very frustrating for him. So he'll leave your website. He'll not recommend your website to anyone or something. So if you're creating anything, just give him a prompt feedback towards it so that he can, he knows what he is doing is correct. See, if you can see in this example, he uploaded something. So nice, congratulations, your file has been uploaded. So the user understands that his file is getting uploaded. So this kind of feedback you need to give. If you can see the second thing, if his file has any error and it's not getting uploaded, then also you need to give the user a feedback so that he can understand what things are going right and what things are going wrong. So this is the way you have to design an action and a feedback screen so that the user can understand what he is doing, if he is going correct or if he is not going correct. If there are any errors also, then you have to display it. So while creating a UI, you create the entire flow of a product, but still you have to create the error screens as well to give him all kind of messages. If he is failing in something, if he needs to do certain steps, all that other screens you have to also incorporate in your UI.
Like so with Amazon, I had seen they show a cute puppy if your internet is...
Right, if your internet is not working properly.
Yeah, they show a cute puppy, oh snap, or something like that. Yes, you've seen this.
So we'll go towards the process of how I work with Riya and what all process we do while creating a UI in our environment. So it all starts with an idea from the stakeholders or the business perspective. There can be an idea, there can be a problem, there can be a need. So we'll take an example of a microsite. It is a pilgrimage microsite. So they came up with an idea to promote a microsite, which gives the user a feel of where they are going and what all kind of products they'll see. So that idea then we design. After designing, we create a final artwork of it, and that artwork will get converted into coding via HTML and into the website, and that's the final product. So idea plus design is equal to reality. So this is the basic process. Now we'll deep dive and what all departments are involved while creating a specific microsite. So process of execution is like this. These are all the departments which are involved while creating a specific product or a website. First, idea comes from the stakeholder or the business point. As I said, there's a microsite which needs to be made. the microsite is about the pilgrim tours. The microsite is about the holiday packages which we need to display. So the next step is the content. As per that idea, as per that requirement, content is created, data is gathered. So as per that data and content, we create a design, we create a layout, and after the layout gets approved, it goes in the other process, that is HTML. After conversion of HTML, we do the development process. So we'll deep dive into this design part and discuss about it. So let's start with an idea. The idea of a microsite pilgrim packages, a microsite that gives a quick overview of activities and experiences and places to visit, a microsite with an unique visual to increase session time and lead gathering. See, whenever you visit a website, there's always a back-end analytics which is going on. They come to know how many users visited your website, how many users are there on your website, and how many bounced back. So while designing a UI, you have to consider all that stuff as well. So other thing is your target audience. So after gathering all the data, after getting all the business requirements, you have to create your target audience personas. So for the pilgrim, we decided that what kind of an age bracket will be there for them. So we came across that age bracket of 35 to 55. They'll be going for the pilgrim tour. And as per that, we design and we gather the images. We collect all the images, what will be relevant. See, images play a main role because visuals speak more than words. So you have to collect images and download images which are relevant, and they can transform the user into that world. So you have to get images which are very high quality, which are good, and which can take the user into that zone. So after that, we come to font. So font selection is also main. See, if you are creating for a corporate, so corporate will require sans serif fonts. If you are creating for kids, then they'll have some cartoonish fonts. For the pilgrim tour, we got the liberty to use typographic font, calligraphic fonts, because it gives a feel to the user that it is something unique. It is something, you can say, design part. It is something, what you can say is, it's a word. You can say it's a special thing which will add to the user. See, boring and special can be differentiated by this. So the third thing is the color palette. As I said, if your target audience is defined, the color palette plays a major role. If you take an example of movies as well, when you see a colorful movie, you know it's a joy. When you see a dark tone movie, then you know it's a thriller or something. So you have to choose a color palette which is relevant to the user as well as to your product. You have to specifically choose the color scheme which will give the mood of that thing to the user. So all these three things keeping in mind, you go towards the next step. And the first step in creating the building block of a design, so that is wireframe. So this is how we initially start with the project. Wireframe, we create a wireframe. It's a blueprint of what all elements will appear on the website. We take into the consideration of business point of view and the content, we place it over it. This is just a rough blueprint. So this provides a hierarchy of what all things will appear next, what all things will come down, where all they will have a button, a call to action. And if you see, then this gives an overview of how your website will look, but in a less UI way. It's more of a blueprint. If you're building a building, you get a blueprint, you get an architect of how the things will be get placed in it. So this is a kind of a blueprint which we create before doing the major part, because it takes less time and it provides you with an efficiency to edit all that stuff. If you create a UI full and you waste a lot of time in that, and if there is a change, then you have to do all that stuff again and again. By doing wireframe initially, you can save your time, and it is very easy to create. You have to keep in mind the business point of view, you have to keep in mind the content, and as per that you have to create the wireframe. After creating a wireframe for all the pages, we send it to the stakeholders to see what all things are lagging. If they have any input, we do the changes into the wireframe only. And after creating all the wireframes, we place it into the XD software and create prototype out of it. The prototype is what you can say, low fidelity design. By prototyping, you come to know how the user journey will flow. See, for a website, the user journey is very simple. For an app, the user journey can have different scenarios. So you have to create a prototype of a wireframe to show how the user will flow from first page to the last page, how he will go. And if there is a set of action which he is missing, then how the different scenario will work. So if you see Amazon, Amazon also have different flows for different products. So you have to take into the consideration how the things will work. So we do the prototyping for it. We present it to the stakeholders. They see how the flow is going. They'll go to the first page. They'll go to the last page. How the user can book, or the user need to generate lead or something like that. And then they provide approval for it. And after getting the approval, we start with the final UI design. So while creating
Rajesh, the UI, just one question, yes, with the prototyping. Do we use any specific software, or how do we actually do this? If you can explain a little bit on that.
Okay, so for us, we use XD for in our company, but there are other softwares as well. Sketch, InVision, and other softwares are there as well. The other companies use them, but we usually use XD. XD is capable, and it is easy with the Adobe family.
XD, so, XD is by Adobe, right? Right.
It's by Adobe. So it is very easy to, you can say, align with the Adobe software, other than InVision and Sketch. So I prefer XD.
Because you guys might be using Photoshop in connection to that, so that integration becomes smooth.
Right. It is very easy for Photoshop integration and as well as Illustrator integration. So it is very easy to us. And XD also provides you with the review function as well. So while presenting to the stakeholders, we get the prompt feedback from the stakeholders on that screen as well, on which section they are having a problem, on which page they are having a problem, and we rectify it in the wireframe stage, and then we update on the prototype part.
So exactly, even in our course that we deliver in UI, we are using Adobe XD as our course delivery pattern.
And XD have now introduced many more features. They have introduced animation, they have introduced online sharing and other stuff. So it is, they also have a UI guide inbuilt library. So you can use that assets and create a UI in a faster way to present the stakeholders, and then you can use Photoshop and create the final UI. So taking into the consideration the previous all steps we took, we create the final UI. And after creating the final UI for all the pages, we again upload them into the prototype and we present it to the stakeholder. So after going through the final UI, the stakeholder provides approval, and then we convert that into HTML. So HTML, we use HTML5. We use HTML5 in our company. So HTML has certain tags which are used. So we use HTML5. This is purely into the coding part. So this is not very much relevant to the UI, but you have to keep a basic HTML in your mind while creating a UI. Because if you create a UI which cannot be converted in HTML, then your UI will be a waste. You have to change your design. So if you have a basic knowledge of HTML, then it is very easy for you to create a UI. So when I worked as a graphic designer, I also did an HTML course to at least understand how the HTML works. So it helped me a lot when creating a UI. Responsive web design. This is very, very important, because nowadays everything, whatever is on the web, it's available on your mobile. So while creating a UI, you have to keep in mind the responsive part in your mind, you have to keep the responsive part in your mind. See, if you're creating a website, you have to think that how it will look on the mobile. So for that, we use Bootstrap. Bootstrap has a 12-column grid. We place that 12-column grid in our Photoshop file. We specifically place all the elements in that specific grid, and we provide it to our HTML artist, and it makes their life easy because they know where to put which element, in which bracket of grid this elements will appear. So you have to specifically stick to that 12-column grid. You can also have an artistic way, but it will lead to more time consumption, and it might not happen. So while designing a UI, you have to design it in a way that if it is visible on a mobile, it should look, and the mobile user should be able to go through the entire UI. So if nowadays, if you see 60% of the users are using a web browser on their mobile. Now also I am using my web browser on mobile. So it is very much necessary to understand how your UI will work in the responsive part. For the mobile apps, it's not a big concern. But while creating a UI for your website, you have to keep in mind the responsiveness. So you have to even have the knowledge of how the Bootstrap 12 column grid works, what all are the specifications for it. You have to discuss it with your HTML artist, and as per that you have to create your UI. So the next step is cross browser compatibility. See, this is a step which is very important. As you develop a website into any of the technology, you have to check that website how it is performing on different browsers. Most of the iPhone users have Safari. They even have Chrome, but the by default browser is Safari. On the desktop, some people have Chrome, some people have Firefox. So while converting into the code, you have to even check how your website is looking into different browsers. We also had Internet Explorer, but now it will discontinue, so we don't check on that. But previously we used to check on that as well. So after cross-checking in on all the platforms, we give it to the development team, where they use the technology framework like ASP.NET and PHP. If your website has a form, they will integrate that form. If your website has any other functionality, they'll integrate that functionality as well. After that, they give a UAT to us. They upload the entire website on a dummy server, and they give to the entire stakeholders. Again, there's an approval process. After approval, they update it to the live server.
So this is Rajesh, are the specific pointers that we look at when it comes to browser compatibility?
See, for the UI part, the UI is simple. But when it comes to coding, there are certain technologies which is not compatible with different browsers. See, HTML5 basic codes will work in it. But okay, if you have certain plugins which you have used in your website while coding, mm-hmm, that plugin might not work in Safari. That plugin might not work in your Firefox. So you have to write an extra set of code so that your website will look similar to all the browsers. So that all things you need to check in that way. So I'll show you the live website, how it looks. So are you able to see my screen?
Yes, yes.
So this is how the live website after UI completion and development looks like. This is the Holy Land package website. As you can see, I placed the logo on the left-hand side because your branding should always be there on the left-hand side top corner.
So Rajesh, can you share the website link? So that, you know, students on their mobile or, you know, that way they can check.
Yeah, sure. We'll do that. They can also go on to
ria.travel.
Yes, that is live. And there you can see in the town section, right, trending now. There we have an Holy Land link over there.
So students can also, all of y'all, whoever are attending the workshop, can go to ria.travel and check the website.
Yes. Simultaneously. We also have different other microsites over there. Then you can also check those as well. We have a microsite for American theme park and nature park microsite. That is also okay. There. We also have a landing page for long weekends this year, which didn't happen, but it's okay. So we also have that website as well.
So and, loading is this. It already loaded. Yeah.
So as you can see, we have differentiated the typo. You can see the packages over here. We have given all the activities over here. We have used the relevant images of that place where the people will go. We have also given this form sticky so that the user should give their information and we should generate lead from it. This is the UI final, which we created. It also works on your mobile as well.
So Rajesh, I must say, I remember your first projects that you had submitted. These are like, way beyond of what it was that time. I'm talking nine years or 10 years back.
If you see this project, this is my first project in Riyadh. And after that, I created many of the websites. So it always improved with the feedback which I got. So this is just an initial project which I did. So I'm presenting it to you because it was the first project and it is very much near to my heart. So I wanted to show it to everybody. Wow. There are many more projects which are coming ahead and we are building it, and sooner or later they'll be live.
Yes. And I also understand those cannot be shared right now. So
so whatever project is live, I'm sharing it with you all. So we'll move forward.
Rajesh, one question I had.
Yeah.
What exactly is the landing page? Is the form page or is the main page, home page when you open a site?
Ma'am, the landing page is a single page website.
Okay.
We create it basically for certain offers. It's like Diwali offer is there, or some Christmas offer is there, any kind of and festival offer is there. Those are the landing pages. A microsite is a small website with 10 to 15 pages. A website is a bigger website with 100 pages or more.
Okay.
So we have defined all that stuff into different categories while creating. See, why is all this necessary? Because whenever the project comes to us, we need to provide a timeline to the stakeholders. So we need to know how many pages need to be created. See, as you saw the entire process, we have to give them a timeline to understand, to make them understand how much time it will take. So if we know it is a website, it will take this much of time. If we know it's a microsite, then it will take this much of time. So we have defined it into the different category. Landing pages, there can be many landing pages. We have offer landing pages, we have informative landing pages for the COVID situation. We have update landing pages. We provide updates of different airline on that landing page. So we have single landing pages, but with other categories. Some are informative, some are offer based, and some are just to provide you with the contact details, how you can connect with the agents.
Call for action, basically.
Yes.
It's majorly for our staff, used our support staff. Yeah, it's majorly used for digital marketing purposes as well. When there is, as he rightly said, then there is a certain offer which we are giving. So yes, majorly used for specific digital marketing offers as well, which they do. Yeah.
Okay, got it.
So this is an in-house visa app which I created. I got this project with a BRD and FRD. While reading that BRD and FRD, I went through the older design as well. I actually did not got the access for the older design, so I'll be sharing you with the new design. In the older design, there was a huge search bar, and they wanted to provide the search bar in a certain functional way that it makes the life easier for the executive who is working on it. They wanted to improvise the UI. The UI had hundreds of applications listed. So they wanted to cut down that listing part as well. So they also wanted to provide with a bulk update screen, so that this was a new part, this was a new functionality. They also wanted to update a bulk application list with a barcode scan. So these were a few functional points which I found from the FRD. FRD is a functional related document and BRD is a business related document. So by reading all this, we created a wireframe, we presented to the stakeholder. after getting approval and after getting approval from the executives as well, we created the UI. So this is the UI. So as you can see, we have a simplified UI. You have a list of applications over here, which are the new application, which are the pending applications, which are submitted. Submitted application as in the visa applications are submitted to the agencies. From there they connect and they provide approval, and after approval they are transferred into the close application. So this is the list which I was talking about. We had hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of lists over here, but we compressed it with the 10 and we gave a pagination over here so that the user should not get confused of how many things are there. So going to the next screen, this is how we made the search bar. So as you can see, there are many options over here. These all options were upfront, and upfront option makes the user confused. So we incorporated this search bar. It's similar to the Amazon search bar. You can select a category and then you can search and go. If you search and go, then this kind of a filter is applied over here, and as per that filter you get a list. So this is a new functionality which we introduced. We had a search bar, but it was very huge and user might get confused, so we compressed it and we created it in this way.
Rajesh, can you also highlight a little bit on the discussions of how this entire thing gets finalized? Like there are few certain select buttons like update visa status. Is this given by the client to you, or you suggest these main headings, or how does that work while you design this?
So we actually had a UI previously. So we took some points from there. They already had this kind of a status. They already had this kind of listing. Right. They already had search, but we redesigned the search. In the FRD, they mentioned that the user can add application manually. So we gave an upfront button to him.
So the FRD plays a major role over here, right, in terms of what all should be there and what all should not be there.
Yes. Yes. FRD gives you an information of what are the prior action which will be taken by an user or executor. So yes, as per that we have to display it on the UI. So the FRD said that he needs to update a visa status upfront. So he need to have this. So we added it upfront. They also said they needed to download the report. Download report, what he'll do, whatever listing is shown over here, they'll get an Excel format. This is all the functional part, but we have provided a call to action so that he can click and get the work done. We also had a few sorting options in the FRD, so we created a small you can see up arrow and down arrow, yes, for the sorting part. And this is the screen for the barcode scan. As you can see, this is the field. The executive will have a barcode scanner with him and a lot of application. He can use that barcode scanner and scan that application. He'll see that number over here. He'll click on add and the application will be listed in this part. He can scan number of application and that will get accumulated over here. After getting accumulated, he can select which one he wants to update. And after selecting, here he can select in which state he wants to update that. So after going here, he can update all, and all the applications will be updated into that state. So this was a new function which was required, and we simplified it in a few steps and gave it to. So as I mentioned earlier, there should be efficiency. So this is how you create an efficiency for the user. See, while creating, you have certain steps in mind. But when the user uses, can get few challenges. As per those challenges, you have to modify your design.
Okay, so how much of we actually allow them to modify? Because there are times when the client actually goes on modifying. So how does, otherwise there is no end to modifications. So how do you manage that? And how do you actually say that, okay, this is final? Or how does that work?
We take into the consideration of how it is making life easy for them. See, if there is an edit by an executive that he don't like the color of this button, so we don't take that into consideration. How the functionality is hampered by that, we take only that into consideration, and we get an approval from the main stakeholder if we need to incorporate that or not. And after that only we tweak that design.
So the major key is functionality shouldn't be hampered. If that is getting hampered, you guys get that.
We don't do anything for that.
For functionality, we don't do.
Yes, for functionality, we don't do.
Okay, so we do it.
Yes.
Yeah. Go ahead.
So I'll talk about one more design. This was OneRia app. OneRia app, it came to us when there was an event in 2018 for managers meet. So they wanted an app for 200 to 300 managers. So for the managers, they wanted to give them a detail of activities, who are the guest speakers who are coming and speaking over there. They also wanted to give them an upload function, like and share button. And also they wanted to provide them with a quiz and ask question. So these were all the major parts which were required from the stakeholders, and we need to keep this in mind and create a UI. So this is how we created a UI for them. So this is the primary screen. This is the main login screen. The employee ID can, the manager can input his employee ID, his date of birth, and can log in. This is the main homepage screen. From here, he can upload anything, he can capture anything, and this is how it will look. We have kept it similar to Facebook, because most of the users use Facebook, so it will not be an hassle for them to connect with them. So this we made this in a familiar way. Then we had the speakers. If you click on the speakers, you get a list of speakers of who all are speaking over here, who all are going to speak. This is the feedback form we had, because this was a small app. So we wanted to give them a feedback form so that they, if they have any problem, they can type in the feedback and give us. We also had a help. This was for the executive and support staff which were working in that event. So if they click on help, they'll get a list of executives. They can directly click on the call button and they can directly call them and get the help from them. And we have the sponsors who all sponsored that event. So this is the menu. We have the event displayed over here. While clicking on the event, they get this kind of a detail. So these are the days mentioned over here. This was a 3 days program, so we listed the 3 days over here. As you can see in the scroll, we have the venue, we have the time, and we have the activity listed over here. So the managers will know what time and what activity will going to happen. Lunch break and speakers are also mentioned over here. So speakers, you can see a small button. So that button was the functionality which was required. This button will only appear when it was done by the backend. The backend only, you can say, they can only display that button in that event. So if a speaker, if any manager want to ask any question to the speaker, he can only display that button. The backend person can only display that button at that time. We also had quiz button over there. So the speaker will ask any quiz on his screen, and that quiz button will appear on that card for the speaker. Clicking on that button, he'll get the you can say Kaun Banega Crorepati type screen. He can select any of the answer and submit. So this is how we created an event app. This was the major functionalities which were required, and these are the screens. These are few examples of my work which I did. This was the RIA website, which you can visit right now and check it out. This was a long weekend project for 2019, last year. This was a microsite with 12 pages, but now we cut it short with the landing page, so you can see one landing page. I don't know if it is live or not, because due to the pandemic, they might have, you can say, removed it. And they have given other landing pages for support purpose. So this is a Singapore visa landing page. This is a single landing page which was created for visa queries. If anybody needs a visa requirement, if anybody has a visa requirement, he can go on this page and read all the details and get his details filled up and get the visa from our company. So these are the kind of mailers which we create. This is a monthly newsletter which we send across our clients all over India. And this is Ria Connect app. This is an ongoing project. We have many products, as you can see. This is going phase by phase. So you can check it out on Play Store. And we have launched our phase for flights and hotels on it. And rest of the things are yet work in progress. So thank you so much for your time and patience for listening to me. Up to you, my sir.
Now we will trouble you with a lot of questions.
Sure. Do any students have any questions to ask?
I have received a couple of them. I think in the meanwhile, I can start. Let the others also. Students, whoever has questions, put it on the chat. We will ask it one by one to Mr. Rajesh. Yeah. So I think first question I will put across to you, Rajesh, is that UI designer should have to work on both, like on website design and as a graphic designer also, or only as a one. Is what he's saying is basically, is a UI designer both, or is he focused on only UI designing and he works on that?
See, UI designing is a branch of graphic design. Graphic design is a vast, you can say, thing. Graphic designing contains print media and other medias as well. UI is a part of graphic design. You have to have a basic knowledge of graphic designing while creating a UI. See, graphic designing is conveying message. Graphic designing is conveying message with images and text. UI designing is same, but you get less efforts because you are constrained with lot of other things other than graphic design. Graphic design is more vibrant, more of a creative part, but UI is less creative because you need to keep functionality in mind. So for UI designing, you have to take it analytically and then design a UI. For graphic, you can be an artist and create a graphic. So there is a difference, but you, if you have a basic knowledge of graphic design, that is good, that will improvise your UI. As I designed Holy Land, I was previously working as a graphic designer. So it gave me an liberty to experiment with my design.
Rajesh, I think you can share your experience as well, like how you were previously a graphic designer.
Yeah.
And then you shifted to UI. So I think that also explains how and what can be the flow for this particular thing.
So the time when I was learning graphic design, at that time UI was not in that much
boom. Absolutely.
But now everything is going in a digital platform. So there's a need to understand and learn UI. If you want to be a UI designer, you should have a basic knowledge of graphic design. In my experience, I was previously working as a graphic designer. I got the opportunity by Datacom. They were into software building and website designing company for insurance agents. So primarily I was creating marketing material like digital creatives for them. So I was creating one pager artwork for them, and I was updating that into the application, which was Magic Gyan. So you can see that Magic Gyan on the Play Store. So my primary work was creating those creatives. But when I was doing that stuff, my manager gave me an opportunity to design a UI. I learned that thing with experience. And I created UI for different brands over there. So you can say from graphic designing to UI, Datacom was the major, you can say, milestone, or you can say a mentor, which helped me from graphic designing to a UI person.
Yes. So and also when you are saying analytical, I still remember we calling you Amir Khan in our days when we used to learn. So yeah, you were the Amir Khan of one of our students, which I used to teach. So now I think that analytical side of you is coming into picture in UI UX.
Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah, so we move on to the next question. It's again from the same student, Dinesh. How to reduce the load time of site I think he's talking about the loading time for the website to be taken. While this type of effects we put increases the site load time also, so how can we reduce that?
There are different softwares for that. Whenever we create a website, we run that URL to a software. That URL provides us with the analytics of how much time the website is taking to load. From a UI point of view, what you can do is you can optimize your images which you are using. You can optimize those images. You can use SVG instead of icons. See, icons, if you provide into the SVG, they'll get converted into code. So code takes less time and images take more time. So if you optimize all your images, the loading time will come less. And you can also tell your HTML people to compress their codes. See, sometimes if they are using more plugins, so the plugins takes more time because they are called from different servers. What they can do is they can compress those plugins. That will also reduce the time. And less code can make your time less. If one result takes 100 code, if that 100 code is reduced to 2 or 1 code, then then the time reduces because browser reads the entire code and then displays it to your displays. Okay. So you have to keep in mind your graphics part, that your images and icons, and you also have to collaborate with the HTML guy to make the code less and the plugins which he is using less. So that will help you to optimize the website.
Okay. So we have another interesting question from Ritik. It's Ritik Shah, one of our students, not Ritik Roshan.
Okay.
So what is the biggest challenge as a UI and UX designer that you face?
The biggest challenge is the user. See, you don't know how the user will react to your product. You can get personas of two or three people, but every mind is different. So you don't know how that user will react to your product. When we created this website, we had certain users in mind. So we created this website. When we created that event app, we had certain users in mind and we created that app. Mm-hmm. But there are hundreds of users. So everybody thinks in a different way. So my challenge was to make everybody's feedback a generic feedback so that everybody can use it. But that is the major challenge because you don't know how the user will react. So right. We have to sometime educate them how to use this website or how to use this app.
Overall, you guys would try and keep it as generic as possible so that
yes,
the education is very less, because otherwise it becomes an expensive deal for the company, because then they have to create few more videos to explain how to use and stuff like that.
Yes, so that is why every website has a help button or support button on them. Because sometimes there might be someone who don't understand anything.
Absolutely. So very well put that, Rajesh. Thank you so much. Next question is from Tanvi. In fact, she is going to pursue our UI designing course. So she's also currently working with Shazam, which is one of the premium brands known across the globe. So her question is, what is your design process and what are the key or basic elements you keep in mind while designing?
UI?
Yes.
Okay.
So design process that you usually, if you want to start something, how do you take that or how do you start basically, you know? The major question is, kaise start karu? So, what's your way of, you know, starting something, if a new project or whatever that is?
Okay. So I'll just elaborate that to the UI part, because the entire process that's into the staging part, which I just explained, I'll just tell you about the UI part, how I do. Majorly, it depends on the BRD and FRD. Okay. When you're creating an initial screen, I need to keep in mind what kind of branding we have to keep, what all content should be displayed, and how the interaction will be there on the
initial. Do you scribble these ideas on a paper, or how do you?
For the wireframing stage, we do. While ideating with the stakeholders, whenever there's a meeting for any new product,
absolutely,
I take my pen and diary with me. This is the diary, and I'll take it with them. And whenever they are speaking any point or whenever they are discussing something, I try and make a rough layout for it,
yes,
and then discuss it with my manager, and then we come up with a final product.
So how difficult it is for you to, earlier used to sketch characters, now you're sketching layouts. I'm sure it's difficult for you.
Actually, it is very easy. You just need to create rectangles and squares, that's it.
Right, I still remember your characters and all which you used to design and then create in 3D Maya and stuff as well.
Characters are way more difficult because they have to have that expression in them.
Yes.
But
yes,
for the UI part, it is very simple. You just need to focus on call to action, and you just need to focus on the content which will be displayed on the UI.
Yes, yes.
It is much simpler.
Yes, yes. So basically, your process is more dependent on what the user wants. You try and show them some examples by drawing and have a rough approval based on the FRD and DRD.
Right. After sketching, we provide them with the wireframe, which I showed earlier. Hmm. So that wireframe goes through the entire stakeholder and the business.
Okay.
After getting approval for that wireframe, we start with the UI part.
Okay. Okay. Right. So I think we are almost reached the end of questions that we have received from the students. I think Swapna ma'am or any of our faculty teams, if have any queries, we can put across.
No, actually, that's it, sir. Whatever I had to... Yeah, Tanvi has one.
Okay, yeah, we have one more question. Images that we upload on website or the user to see, according to you, what should be the image size, like under what KB the image should be so that it doesn't take too long time to load?
There's no specific size for it. You have to compress it until it looks good, but the size is very low. You can't make it very low. If the image gets blurred, then it is of no use. You have to maintain that quality and that size as well. So it's an experiment process. So while compressing image, you have to see how it looks in an actual scenario and the size of an image. So there's no specific size for it, but the more, the less, the more efficient it is.
And also, I believe some way or the other, the size will be there. It's how much best you can do with the size is what basically should be the logic with it. As you said, there is no right size parameter in numbers, but until the quality loss is not happening, till then is where probably you can do a reduction of the file size.
Right.
So
one doubt I had, Rajesh. I wanted to know how do you charge the clients? Like, it is on the basis of time taken, or number of images, or number of pages, or what's the criteria? Or depending on the client.
It actually depends on the client entirely.
First he gives his budget and then accordingly you work, or you give your prototype and then he like deletes or adds things?
My process of, it's a freelancing part. So my process when I interact with the client is, I take all the requirements from him. I create a rough wireframe. I send to him and explain each and every section to him, and as per that discussion, if he likes it, I create a invoice in which I mention the number of pages he requires and how much functionality is required. Based on that, I quote my final price.
Now the question is how much? He was avoiding the question.
How much, that depends on the client.
That you contact him directly, privately.
You can give us a rough idea or something like that. That, you know, you never know if you might get a project from here. So yeah, so give us an idea, like minimum you would charge this much for a UI design, or maximum you would, you know. Minimum also you can...
Like a rough range.
Yes. We will not let you pass this question.
for 5 to 6 pager website, I usually charge, not for the UF, for the entire website, is around 80,000.
Okay. Great. So this is something which is kind of a motivation, or you can say this is something which is kind of an idea giving thing to the students, that they can look at getting onto these levels, but not probably when you were as a student, probably you wouldn't have asked this kind of a money. But yes, once now you've been, I think 8 years is 80,000, I guess. So you've been in the industry for 8 years and you've reached a level where if you create 6 pages of a website, you can charge 80,000. The company might bargain and bring you down to maybe 70 or, but yeah, that is how much these kids can look to actually make some money out of it. Yeah, so we wanted them to understand that yes, you know, there is money if you know how to do the skill right and do it better day on day. That's how.
Right.
Yeah. So I had one question with regards to the clarity part, or the target audience part, wherein you were talking about images, you were talking about fonts and colors. Can you a little bit go further on that one topic, especially with regards to fonts and colors? Because what happens is Photoshop has spoiled our students with so many fonts. In fact, it's not enough, we can add more. So if you could go a little bit in detail of this combination of font versus color versus background, you know, this bit, if you could extend a bit more on that.
Okay, for the images part, I'll go through it. For the images, you have to stick to images which are bold and clear. So you have to select a set of image which gives a direct message but are not very cluttered. Because the more the colors, the more it will take time to compress and it will not look good. So you have to stick to bold images with less of clutter. And for the as you are asking font part, we usually use Google fonts because they are much more compatible with browser. We don't use offline fonts from Photoshop because we have to update it on the server and it might not work in all the browsers. We have a limitation for that. We use Google fonts. And as per that, you have to also have in mind the audience which for whom you are creating. See, if it is a corporate website, you have to stick to a sans serif or a corporate-ish font, as I said. And if it is an artistic website, then you can have a liberty of using a calligraphic font, but it has to be a Google font.
Right.
So that it loads easier and it looks good on all the browsers.
And how about the color? Like, how do you choose colors? Is there a sense which goes in your mind? Is it based on the client? Is it based on your liking or what you like? Or how does that?
Mostly, when we get a project which already have a guideline set, we do not choose any color apart from that. In the guidelines, colors are mentioned already. So we try and use a combination of those colors. Apart from them, when you don't have a guideline and when it comes to choosing colors, we keep a specific set of user in mind and the product. When creating this Holy Land website, we want to give it a holistic effect. So white and more saturated colors were our priority. And to give user that feeling that he is there already in Holy Land. So we set, we created a number of.
Yeah, any more doubts any other students have got?
Yeah, I think one question is from Ritik. What are the questions that you ask to the client as a when you start a project? What are the basic questions? Am I audible?
Yeah.
You are off, sir. Now suddenly, you're off.
Okay. Yeah. So, what are the basic questions that you ask to the client so that you actually kind of understand the product more better? Or what are the questions that you start with? suppose it's your first meeting with the client, so how do you actually pitch the product or understand the product?
So you are asking for the freelancing part or the
any okay. When it's a freelance, you ask the client directly. When it's you're receiving from your boss, so again you would have certain questions there. So what are those set of questions when you try to understand the project?
The first question is that what is the goal which user need to fulfill. So while creating a website, we need to know if it is for online booking. So booking has a different flow. If it is a lead generation, so lead generation has a different flow. If it's just an informative website, so informative website just shows you information. That's it. There's no major call to action.
So first we understand the objective of the
right.
First understand the objective of the client.
Yes. So you need to know the goal which need to be fulfilled. As per that goal, we start the process. The second thing is what the business will get out of it.
Return on investment. Sorry.
Right. So first is the goal for the user. The second is the goal for the business. So all that stuff, and majorly it's the basic questions are how many pages will be there, any kind of functionality add-on is there, because for the UI part it is majorly on the functionality. So if you have a unique functionality, then you have to make it simplified. If it is not simple, then your UI doesn't make any sense. And if you make a UI very simple but it is not functional, then your UI doesn't make any sense.
Got it.
Functionality is also a major part which you have to keep in mind and create UI.
So objective and the functionality, these are two major understanding that you would get into first priority before starting any new project, right? Okay.
Yeah. Usually, usually we get a BRD and FRD for that. So we read the entire, because everything is mentioned in that BRD and FRD. So if there is an add-on to that,
Do you have any sample BRD FRD sheet in with you? Which
that is.
Acha, okay,
that
okay.
Is very confident.
I'm getting too close. Okay. So we have one more question. Do we need digital marketing as well? Like when we are doing UI, do I need to know digital marketing?
If there's a product and people don't know about it, then it's of a waste. So you have to promote it some way or the other on the digital platform.
No, but as an artist, do I need to know?
As an artist, you should know it. As an artist, you should know it because it will help you to promote.
So let's say if he doesn't promote, okay, it might be, the question is primarily, is it a different department who does the digital marketing?
Yes.
Or
yes,
is it that I only have to do digital marketing as well?
No. So we have a different department, marketing
exactly.
department, who does that job for us. We create artworks for them
for
to
them.
Promote. Yes, they give us a requirement for visa product or hotel product or some other packages launched. They give us a content and we create a flyer or an emailer or something for that. And they are the major key players who promote that across the platforms. So we may not do the marketing, but we create certain creatives for them.
Yes. All right. Wow. Thank you so much, Rajesh. I think that sums up pretty well with the UI designing thing. I think any other questions, Lars, Swapna ma'am, or anyone? I think.
No. We are done.
All right. So I think we can end the session here. And thank you so much, Rajesh, for sharing your experience. It was very fluent. You could share your experience in a much simpler and to the point way. And we hope to hear a lot more sessions from you, and any time in future, if you feel there is something new that you wish to share, do share with us. We will put you up as a sharing person with the students. Yes.
Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Thank you, Rajesh, very much.
It was my pleasure.
I hope the students will use all this information.
Yes.
Yeah, sure.